Hello everyone, welcome to Thursday Tales. I know recently you have celebrated your Friendship Day with your friends. Let's hear the story of Jill, Minnie and Sandy, how they celebrated their Friendship Day. So let's start.
I'm in Mysore. I'm seeing you after 5 years. Where are you nowadays?
Oh, I'm in Odisha. Well, Mysore is the city with great historic events.
Yeah, and Odisha too had its own story during the past. Well, where is Jill nowadays?
Oh, we three were the good friends in childhood. Wait, I'll connect him also.
Hey friends, how are you doing?
Nothing, just...
Thank you.
Same to you.
So where are you nowadays, Jill?
I am in Lucknow.
Oh, we three are residing in different parts of India. Mysore, Lucknow and Odisha.
Yes, different economic policies were implemented by Britishers when they came to India.
In the pre-colonial period, the Indian economy was predominantly based on agriculture. But the new patterns of land ownership and revenue policies that were brought by the Britishers destroyed completely the existing agrarian system in India.
Yes, and the Mughals during their period, they had 3 types of lands. The lands given to Mansabdars, the Khalisa land and the Enam land. And when the Mughal Empire declined, then the government started a new revenue collection system, that is the Ijara system. And in this, the tax collectors were appointed as agents to collect tax, and they kept 1/10 with them. Zamindars were the intermediaries between government and peasants.
Yes, you both, Minnie and Sandy, are correct. But the revenue collection system became worse when the East India Company came to India. After the Battle of Buxar, when they got Diwani right, they started interfering into the political affairs of our country. And they needed revenue for regular income to build an army, train it and expand. Before 1865, the company had purchased goods in India by importing gold and silver from Britain. But now, this revenue collection could finance the purchases of goods for export. Then, when the Warren Hastings became Governor General of India, he started a new Ijadari system, in which the auction was made and the highest bidder was given right to collect revenue. This system was having too many loopholes, so it also didn't work, and nobody benefited from it.
Well, Minnie, please tell us the revenue system in Odisha.
See, Lord Cornwallis became Governor General in 1786. Then he introduced permanent settlement in Bengal, Bihar and Odisha. He made Rajas and Talukdars as Zamindars, and these Zamindars were made landlords, while the cultivators became tenants, and they all lost their rights. And there was a regular flow of income to the government, that is, the company's treasury. And on the other hand, it encouraged zamindars to invest to improve the land. Lord Cornwallis made the settlement a permanent one by regulation. And during this, company was assured of financial security, that is, regular flow of income, even in case of bad harvest. But the situation of tenants was worse because they became beggars. They were unable to pay the land revenue, so they had to borrow it from the money lenders by mortgaging their land. And if they were not able to pay them, then they used to confiscate the land and they were left beggars. Now, Sandy, you please tell something about the Rayatwari system that was there in Mysore.
The Rayatwari system was introduced in Karnataka, Mysore, Madras and Bombay presidencies. It was introduced by Thomas Munro and Captain Ray. There were many advantages and disadvantages. The best one, that the cultivators or rayats were recognized as owners of the land. There were no intermediaries. The revenue demand was half of the produce, depending on quality of soil and nature. Then, the revenue was fixed for a period of 30 years. This system was again rigid without any remission. This was the disadvantage. Government had right to increase land revenue at the will, and peasants had to pay whether he increased his production or had a famine. And at the end, he was transformed into bonded labor. So, now, you also, Jill, please tell us about the Mehelwari system prevailing in the north of India.
The Mehelwari system was introduced firstly in Agra and Awadh, then in Madhya Pradesh, Punjab, Delhi and other parts of India. In this system, land was not owned by an individual, be it zamindar or rayat, but by Mehel. What is Mehel, do you know? Mehel was a group of villages. The revenue was collected by the head of the Mehel. He was also called the Talukdars. The social and economic inequalities increased and peasants' lot deteriorated. The village headman and prominent families retained right of the land, once again reducing common rights into landless tenants. So this was also having the end result that the tenants became laborers, or we can also say beggars.
So these are the revenue systems that were prevailing in the past when at the places where we are residing. But what do you think that the effect of these systems were worst on the people? Say it, landlords, their status was reduced merely to the rent collectors. And the other, they became the mouthpieces of British officials. And the peasants, they were pushed into the clutches of money lenders. Then the legal system was also not helpful, as the poor peasants, they were not able to hire a lawyer. And the situation of artisans and craftsmen and handicraft industry was also worse day by day.
Yes, Mini, you are correct. But this system discouraged joint family system and it promoted individualism. The people started producing for market instead of fulfilling the needs of village people.
No. This is nothing, friends. The worst thing was yet to come. That is the commercialization of agriculture. When, in order to pay land revenue in cash, peasants had to sell their products in the nearby market and they were forced to sell his produce at a very low price. And as the result of industrial revolution in England, the demand of cash crops like indigo, cotton, etc. was increased. And these cash crops made maximum profit to the merchants of Britishers. They were pressurized to grow only these crops so that the Britishers can earn more profit. And this reduced the production of food stock and led to famine. We were having nothing to eat.
Yes, Jill, you are correct. And the end result, we all of us know. The number of battles by the farmers, zamindars and the former soldiers. The princes also joined them. All of them were disappointed by the Britishers' revenue collection system. They were unable to pay the land revenue and zamindars were not able to collect it. The Mufla farmers of Kerala and the Deccan riots in Pune and Ahmednagar. There were many revolts that were going on during that time. The government of India had to appoint a commission for that. And the cultivators made them attract the rich moneylenders. The largest of such uprising revolts was the revolt of 1857, the popular one.
The black days, in fact I should call the blue days of our Indian history, were the Indigo Revolt. The European traders wanted Indian peasants to cultivate indigo. Why? Because it was not available at their native places. So they wanted us to cultivate for them because of their benefit. And the adversities like being kidnapped, tortured and the crop being destroyed was done. The indigo agitation in Bengal in 1859-60 directed against European planters whose exploitation had pushed the peasants to the wall. And in 1860, all cultivators undertook the first great general strike. And about the Neel Darpan, you might be knowing. It was the famous play that was portrayed. The final blow came when a synthetic dye was invented and Mahatma Gandhiji's efforts in 1918 that finally gave relief to the poor peasants of Champaran in Bihar.
These were the revolts, but there was one Wahhabi movement also, that in that the Muslims came in front. That was the poor Islam carried on a struggle against British rule. Muslims from all walks participated and its main objective was primarily religious, but later on it assumed the character of a struggle. And Fakir and Sanyari rebellion movement in all around Bengal were also movements of mass uprising.
In our irrigation brought about many changes in Punjab. The upcoming of British witnessed introduction of relatively advanced technology. The Upper Bhari Doab Canal was the first one to be built in 1860. The Sarhind Canal irrigation makes it a rich agriculture region. The Kenna irrigation system is the largest in the world.
Our Indian history is a rich history. We can't stop ourselves from discussing it for hours and hours.
Really, friends, but it was a great experience that today we were discussing about the places that we are residing, three different places and their revenue systems.
And the resultant rewards due to these revenue systems and the commercialization of agriculture. And at the end, the Punjab's case study. Okay, friends, this was the friendship day that we have to celebrate online only.
I too felt really relaxed discussing to you something very important about the Indian history. And yes, we'll meet soon. Hope to meet you.
Okay, it was nice talking to you, Jill and Sandy. Okay, Minnie and Jill, bye-bye. I have to wish my other friends also. Nice talking to you.
Bye. Happy Friendship Day once again.
Bye-bye. See ya.
I hope all of you understood Chapter 3, Rural Life and Society of History, and also understood the story of the three friends and their Friendship Day celebration by video call. Thank you.